Good day, everyone. My name is Teacher Claire. Welcome to another lesson of Facilitating Learner-Centered Teaching. In this lesson, we will be discussing Ossebel Subsumption Theory. The learning objective for this lesson is to demonstrate understanding of Ossebel Subsumption Theory, discuss the four processes of meaningful learning, and explain when to use a specific advanced organizer. David Ossebel is an American psychologist who developed this theory, which focuses on how individuals acquire and learn large chunks of information through visual means. Ossebel's main contribution was the development of advanced organizer. David Ossebel believed that the most important factor influencing the learning is the quantity, clarity, and organization of the learner's present knowledge. For better understanding, we define subsumption as a process by which new material is related to pertinent ideas in the existing cognitive domain of a person. This time, let's discuss the four processes that a learner must experience to have a meaningful learning. First, the derivative subsumption. Ossebel claimed that a new material derives from the existing structure, and this material can be linked to another concepts, leading to new interpretations. Second, we have the correlative subsumption. This is claimed when the new material is an extension of the already grasped knowledge. For instance, you have learned about this new kind of bird through the process of correlative subsumption. In a sense, you might say this is more valuable learning than that of derivative subsumption since it enriches the higher level concept. For the superordinate learning, it claimed that one could only learn a concept itself until it was taught to a person. For example, a child is well acquainted with banana, mango, guava. But the child didn't know until she was taught that these were all examples of fruits. In this case, the child already knew a lot of examples of the concept, but didn't know that this concept itself until it was taught to her. Combinatorial learning. This is when newly acquired knowledge combines with prior knowledge to enrich the understanding of both concepts. This learning is actually the learning by analogy. This describes a process by which the new idea is derived from another idea that is neither higher nor lower in the hierarchy, but at the end level, in a different but related branch, it's done. For example, to teach someone about how plants breathe, you might relate it to the previously acquired knowledge of the human respiratory, where man inhales oxygen and exhales carbon dioxide. Ossebel's theory further highlighted the use of advanced organizers as anchored on the principle of subsumption theory. He thought that the primary way of learning was subsumption, a process by which new material is related to relevant ideas. Ossebel likewise pointed out that what is learned is based on what is already known. Moreover, advanced organizer, according to Ossebel, gives two benefits. First, it's easier to connect new information with what is already known, and second, to see how concepts relate to each other. In addition, Ossebel enumerated the four types of advanced organizers. We have the expository, an organizer that simply describes new concept; narrative, an organizer that presents new information in a story format; scheming, an organizer that is looking over a new material to gain a basic overview; And the last, the graphic organizer, which visualizes an outline of new information. This may include pictographs, concept patterns, or concept maps. At this juncture, let us identify the different types of graphic organizer and learn when to use such organizer. First, we have the STAR diagram, which is used when the topic involves investigating attributes associated with single topic or concept. This is useful for basic brainstorming about a topic or simply listing all the major traits related to a theme. Second, we have the spider map. This is utilized if the topic involves investigating attributes associated with single topic and then obtaining more details of each of these ideas. This is actually similar to a STAR graphic organizer with one more level of detail. Next, we use a fishbone diagram if the topic involves investigating multiple cause and effect factors associated with a complex topic and how they interrelate. Then we need to use clustering diagram if the topic involves generating a web of ideas based on a stimulus topic. Tree diagram, on the other hand, is usually used if the topic involves a chain of events with a beginning and with multiple outcomes at each node, like a family tree. We also have chain diagram. This is used if the topic involves a linear chain of events with a definite beginning, middle, and end. We may also use a chain of events graphic organizer if the topic involves a linear chain of events with a definite beginning, middle, and end. We can also use cycle diagram if the topic involves a recurring cycle of events with no beginning and no end. We use flowchart diagram if it involves a chain of instructions to follow. Like in MSU, we have the enrollment flowchart. Venn diagram, on the other hand, is commonly used when it involves examining the similarities and differences between two or three items. However, we can use chart diagram if the task involves condensing and organizing data about traits of many items. We can also use Y chart if the task involves analyzing and organizing with respect to three qualities. We may also use pie chart if the task involves showing divisions with a group. Lastly, we use T-chart if the task involves analyzing or comparing with two aspects of topic. So that ends my lesson about Ossible theory and its graphic organizers. Thank you for watching. See you in my next video. Once again, this is Teacher Claire.